if any planet's going to have a moon, it's this. This is the perfect planet to have a moon. And I will like eat my hat if this planet does not have moons.
Have you ever wondered what it's like to discover a brand new world? In the last 3 decades, we've found over 5,000 planets outside our solar system, called exoplanets. I'm Dr. Jessie Christensen, the lead scientist at the NASA Exoplanet Archive. This is Explore Exoplanets, The Discoverers, a series where I interview the brilliant minds behind the discovery of brand new planets. Hello, everybody. Welcome back to Explore Exoplanets, The Discoverers. Today's guest is searching for possibly the only thing cooler than exoplanets. So let's get into the show. If you're watching this on YouTube, you can also listen to it as a podcast. Head to Apple Podcasts or Google Play and take us with you on your morning commute. If you're listening to us, you can also watch us on YouTube, where you'll find some bonus graphics to help explain what my guest and I are talking about. Speaking of which, we're joined today by Dr. David Kipping, Assistant Professor of Astronomy at Columbia University. Hello, David.
Hey, Jessie. Thanks for having me on your show.
No worries. I'm really excited to have David here. David and I were colleagues a million years ago, or 15 years ago, at Harvard University. We were postdocs together there.
I remember it well. Yeah, I remember the SSP coffees, and it was great days. Yeah, we used to have such great conversations about the exciting Kepler news and everything happening in the world of exoplanets. So yeah, I remember those times, yeah.
I remember those. I also remember it was 2009 and the global financial crisis was happening. And I also remember a lot of very stressful conversations about whether either of us would ever get a job. But here we are now. We have jobs.
We got through somehow.
So where are you physically right now?
I'm in New York City in Manhattan, so Upper West Side at Columbia University. And I guess I've been here for probably 8 years now since I left Harvard and then I came here.
Does New York feel like
well settled in at this point. I feel like a New Yorker, which takes a while to get used to. A New Yorker with a British accent, but somehow that's quite normal here, actually.
Okay. Yeah. And then career-wise, where are you? Talk us through how you got to being a British accent on Upper West Side in New York City.
Okay, so I studied at Cambridge for my undergrad, then I did my PhD at UCL in London, and I think it was in my second or third year of that, that Gaspar Bakos, who was at the CFA at the time at Harvard, he was advertising for a postdoc, and I was just a big fan of his work. It was a massive fan of the HatNet survey, which was discovering planets. Mm-hmm. So I emailed him and said, look, I'm too junior for this position. I know that, but I just want to say I'm a huge fan of what you're doing, and I hope one day I can work with you. And he said, well, why don't you come join me as a pre-doc? Mm-hmm. And so, I'd like, what the hell is a pre-doc? Never heard of that before. So right. I ended up coming as a pre-doc, which is this thing, which is kind of somewhat unusual. We don't have it in the UK too much, but mm-hmm. it was kind of amazing. You get paid twice, essentially. You get paid your stipend.
Doing your PhD, but you're doing another project while you're doing your PhD.
Yeah, yeah. They kind of put it on pause a little bit. I think, well, actually, it was kind of like a half-half. So I was getting like half my normal stipend and then half of the money from the CFA. Ended up pretty good for me as a student.
Sure.
And then Gaspar eventually left to Princeton. He got a job there. I stayed on at the CFA as a Sagan Fellow, mm-hmm. As a postdoc, and then as a Menzel Fellow for a couple of years after that. So I think I was there for like 5 years in total. Mm-hmm. Really hung around the CFA for a while by postdoc standards. And then got a job here at Columbia about 8 years ago.
Okay. So thinking back to when you were an undergrad at Cambridge and then a PhD student at UCL, did you ever think that you would discover exoplanets? Was this something you were aiming for from the start or something you kind of fell into?
Yeah, I think it was a strange journey. I'd always obviously loved astronomy and space and all that kind of jazz, as many of us do growing up. Mm-hmm. And then I was studying physics at Cambridge, not astronomy.
Okay.
And I only did one lecture that mentioned exoplanets. And I just thought this was it, like this was so cool. they were saying, oh, by the way, you know, it's not very interesting, but there's this thing called exoplanets happening.
And
yeah, they've discovered a few, I think they're now at 3 or 4 exoplanets or something. And I was like, that's amazing. Like, I want to be involved in that. That sounds much more exciting than, by the way, Maxwell's equations that were figured out 200 years ago, whatever it was.
Right.
Like, this was something new. It just felt like enticing to get involved in it. So yeah, I was thinking of, and then I looked around the UK for where I could do an exoplanet PhD, and there wasn't very many places. There was like 4 or 5 PhDs.
Right. And it was one the same of them, in Australia at that time.
Yeah, it was hard. And so I found one. It was supposed to be on exoplanet atmospheres.
Okay.
With Giovanni Tinetti. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I remember when I arrived at UCL, I got this huge textbook put on my desk, like this thick of radiative transfer. Mm-hmm. Like, she was like, you know, work through that for a couple of weeks.
Come back to me when you're ready.
Yeah. And I like got through like the first chapter or two of it. And I was like, oh my God, this is horrendous. And I had an idea that I'd been thinking about over the summer of trying to calculate, basically from lecture notes in Cambridge, like how do you calculate the transit duration of an exoplanet? We did that in class, but I wanted to do it for an eccentric orbit. Mm-hmm. And weirdly enough, that basically hadn't been done yet. It was kind of amazing. Back then, there was all this like low-hanging fruit that nobody had done.
Back in the day.
So I just showed up at my advisor's office like 6 weeks later after starting my PhD. And she was like, I assume you've read the book by now. I was like, well, no, but here's a paper I wrote. And I just put this on, I put a paper on her desk. And that ended up being my first paper, and I thought she was going to kill me, but she was really supportive and was
That's
like, this
great.
this is amazing. Yeah, you should just do this. This is clearly your thing.
There's a spectrum of like micromanagement of PhD advisors. So it's good that you landed on someone who was going to be like, all right, you went off and wrote a paper. Great. Cool. Well done.
Yeah. Yeah. I guess it was similar for you then. It was like people weren't really, exoplanets was still kind of a new thing over there as well in Australia.
Yeah, so there was an exoplanet survey that was starting at the South Pole, and I was like, yes, getting in on the ground floor, and then it never worked. We never got any data.
Well, that's a hard place to do a survey.
It turns out it is difficult, and if something breaks, you're really stuffed. So, yes, there weren't a lot of options, but I got to go to the South Pole, so that's pretty cool.
And see some penguins.
Not at the South Pole, but on the edge of Antarctica at McMurdo, there were penguins.
Well, that makes it all worth it.
Yes, absolutely. And seals. So, you thought exoplanets were exciting. You were thinking of ways to characterize them better. Tell us a story of discovering a planet.
Yeah, I guess the planet I'll mention is Kepler-167e, which is this very, very long period planet. So in a thousand seventy days orbital period. Mm-hmm. And it's in my mind a lot because it's a planet I discovered 7 years ago. It's the planet that I used to kick off the Cool Worlds YouTube stuff I did. So when I made that discovery, I think it was pretty much my first year arriving here at Columbia. And it was kind of like a hangover project pretty much from the CFA at Harvard. And I'd said to, at the time, Willie Torres was developing and had been working on this software called Blender, which was a way of basically validating exoplanets, which is now kind of run of the mill stuff. But back then we were still
for tests as well now.
Yeah. Back then we were kind of figuring out a little bit how this stuff all works. And Blender was kind of the state of the art package for doing this. But I remember at the time it took like weeks and weeks to run on
slow.
NASA supercomputer would be running one planet for weeks just to like validate one thing, but it was all we had. And so I was really interested in planets at long orbital periods because I was so interested in looking for moons. So I remember kind of scouring through the KOI catalog, which I often did, probably one of the catalogs that you made, Jesse, and
probably.
You know, scouring through that catalog and just looking at what was the longest period stuff. And this object stuck out to me as just like, oh, this is almost surely going to be a real planet, because there was three planetary candidates already on the inside. Mm-hmm. So these were very, very close to the star, sort of 1/20th of an AU separated from the star. And there was three kind of 1.5 Earth radius planets on these, you know, apparently circular orbits. And then far out that, even far outside the Habitable Zone, you'd have this gas giant, which was 10 Earth radii, so about the size of Jupiter.
Right, pretty big.
And it was also kind of like a mini solar system. I think that's what was appealing to it. You know, the solar system has the inner rocky planets and then the outer gas giants. And so this kind of looks like
I was going
like
to ask
that.
Because a thousand days, I was going to ask if it was actually a KOI because that's such a long period, you wouldn't get three transits in the Kepler observations. Was there just one transit?
Well, you know what? There was the early days of the KOIs were kind of weird because you probably know more about this than I do, but there was some stuff that just really shouldn't be in there that was in there. And yeah, you're right. You're supposed to have three transits, but there was some stuff that had two transits. Or even
people
some
were
stuff
just kind of manually
transit.
Shoving stuff in right at the start. until people like me who really wanted to do statistics were like, please don't manually shove stuff into the catalog.
So I think the KOI number was 490. So it's kind of like a lowish KOI
early
number.
Days.
So. And because it already had three planets in the system, probably somebody saw the two giant deep transits and was like, oh, this deserves a KOI number as well. Right. So I don't know who spotted the KOI identification, but it just stuck out to me in the catalog as, well, this is obviously the kind of place where I want to look for moons, I want to look for rings, it's beyond the snow line, and we need to validate this. And then once we validate it, we can, you know, get into all the more interesting science. So to me, like the planet discovery aspect was more like just a nuisance. Like let's just get this out of the way.
Right.
So we can like prove to everyone it's worthwhile, you know, chasing after.
And have you searched for moons around this planet?
Well, we have kind of checked in the Kepler data. The Kepler data, there's only two transits, so it's very hard in the Kepler data to do much, and it's not the brightest of stars. But we just found out yesterday that we were awarded James Webb Space Telescope time to point at this object.
Hooray!
And look for exo moons. So yeah, I'm over the moon. And obviously this over the moon, like the pun. Pun not intended, but it was an amazing object to go after for this, because the planet is not only we could tell it was one Jupiter radius, it was a 0.92 Jupiter radii from the Kepler light curve, but subsequently I think it was Paul Dauber has been able to measure the mass with radial velocities, and that comes out at 1.01 Jupiter masses. So it's basically the same as Jupiter in mass and radius. It's on a circular orbit. It's in a multi-planet system. It's around a quiet star, a K-dwarf star. It's beyond the habitable zone. If any planet's going to have a moon, it's this. This is the perfect planet to have a moon. And I will like eat my hat if this planet does not have moons. Like, otherwise, we have to like rip up the textbook of how moons form if this thing doesn't have moons.
So you mentioned it has a 24-hour transit. So how much JWST data did you have to ask for to look for moons around it?
Well, a lot. We asked for 60 hours of telescope time.
Wow.
And
so for folks at home, that's a lot of time.
There'll probably still be, you know, we'd still probably want to hit it twice, not just once, but we'd have to wait 3 years longer for that, unfortunately, because it takes so long to transit a star. But we're really hoping this, you know, triggers off the ExoMoon catalog, and then you could write a whole new catalog for the ExoMoons, or somehow blend it into the planet catalog that you work on, Jesse.
Right. We have a column ready for exomoons. Okay, so you've talked a lot about this very cool exomoon hunt. Is that your favorite real planet?
I think at the moment, I think, obviously, the TRAPPIST-1 system, everyone loves that system. It's just a fascinating, I love that system dynamically. It's just so much fun. So I've been really enjoying seeing the results coming out of that thing. But, you know, I think you've said this before on a podcast. I've heard you say this on Jesse, and I kind of nodded my head in agreement, but correct me if I'm wrong, that my favorite planet is always the next planet. And that's always how I kind of feel. Like I'm always most excited to talk about the stuff that I'm not really supposed to talk about, which is, you know, like the stuff that's
not quite ready to be published yet.
I'd be a terrible spy. I'd just really be like always spilling the beans.
That's great. Okay, so your favorite planet is the next one. I love it, obviously, and agree. Let's wrap it up. What's your favorite fictional planet?
Yeah, I think Miller's planet from Interstellar.
Okay, he's giving us a wild one, folks. That's it for this segment. Please follow us on Instagram, Facebook, and Twitter. And wherever you're enjoying this, please like and subscribe or rate and leave a review. Join us next episode to find out more about David's favorite fictional planet, Miller's planet from Interstellar, and its real-world counterpart in the NASA Exoplanet Archive. Thanks, everyone.